and sisters, we gather for worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
As we prepare to celebrate the mystery of Christ's love, let us acknowledge our failures and ask the Lord for pardon and strength, first keeping a moment of quiet reflection. Grant that we may serve thee in newness of life, to the glory of God. mercy never fails. Deepen our faithfulness to you and to your living word, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. A reading from the letter to the Romans. Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in the newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like this, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like this. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed, that we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over us. The death he died to sin, once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground unperceived by your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I also will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I also will deny before my Father in heaven. not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
So, in union with Christ and the power of the Spirit, we come before you now. The available images online which correspond to our gospel reading today are largely concerned with betrayal, violence, and so on. As the front of today's service booklet, Christ Wielding a Sword, shows. That said, the gospel reading this morning, it seems to me, isn't quite as black in tone as might first be expected. Yes, much of it stands as a warning from Christ to his followers that there will be troubles ahead for them and for us. It speaks of the cost of discipleship. It is certainly a gospel passage which can be challenging to preach on. Yet those middle verses can be seen as an exhortation to faithful discipleship and trust in the midst of extreme difficulty and adversity. In this passage, we have the promise that no matter what may happen, or however hard our Christian life may become, God will be there for those who are faithful to him. He is there for those who are faithful to him because of his extraordinary love for all creation. There is nothing in the whole of creation which is unaffected by the Creator's loving touch. From the largest whale or elephant to the smallest, most insignificant insect, even it would seem the slugs inhabiting the rectory garden. God has passed his creative and protective hand over. The large mammal, the tiny insect, the sparrow, becomes something which is part of the divine creation and plan. And in the midst of that divine creation is that strange species known as humanity. Male and female, we are cast in the image of God. We are the ones given responsibility for stewardship of the earth and of living our lives in such a way that we proclaim God's gospel of love. But we do not live in an ideal world. There are many who, at best, look on members of the church as perhaps slightly out-of-date do-gooders, and, at worst, in some parts of the world, persecute the church simply for proclaiming a gospel of total love and reconciliation. And perhaps we are right to be fearful, if not for ourselves, then for our persecuted sisters and brothers elsewhere in the world. And remember, there are parts of the world where the church is persecuted not only for differing religious beliefs, but often for being a sharp thorn in the side of corrupt and dictatorial governments. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, Oscar Romero, and others, even in the 20th century, stand as examples of such thorns. So it seems that we are right to be wary of the world in which we live and work. We should be wary because if we don't look after ourselves, just who will? The answer, of course, is obvious, and we find it in our Gospel reading. Matthew takes the image of the sparrow to show the extent of God's overflowing love. Here, the cheapest form of life to be found in the marketplace, in the time that Matthew was writing, is cited. In the marketplace of first century Israel, the sparrow is of little consequence. It is a pest. If God's providential care extends even to it. The assurance is simple and yet starkly true. If God loves and protects the sparrows of the air, how much more would he protect and love us, who are of far more value in his sight? Now the rest of the passage makes it plain that living the Christian life will not be the proverbial bowl of cherry. Being a Christian does not mean having the easy way through things. It does not mean having a life of comfort and ease. We will be faced with difficult challenges. We will be called upon to pick up our own cross and carry it day by day. But in all that faces us in our Christian pilgrimage, Matthew in this passage exhorts us day by day to place our trust in God, for ultimately we can do nothing else. Our television screens, newspapers, internet, day by day bombard us with images which seem to suggest that placing trust in God is naive and pointless. Society may well ask the question, why on earth does God let such and such happen? Where was he when the bomb exploded? And so on. The answer, of course, is found on the cross. God in Christ is not divorced from our pain and our suffering, rather he is in the middle of it, sharing it. He is there in the middle of the coronavirus. He has been there in the Nightingale hospitals. He's been there with those families mourning the loss of loved ones. God himself knows what it is to feel pain, anger, and desolation, because he experienced all three in the events of Calvary. And it is because he has experienced and continues to experience those emotions, and it is because he is God and we are not, that he is perfect. It is because of those things that he is the focus for our hope and our trust. So are we worth more than two sparrows? And does he care enough about me to know the number of the hairs on my head? And I don't say that jokingly. The answer, of course, is a resounding yes. We have been living through challenging, difficult and painful times. Our way of life has been turned upside down, inside out, back to front by coronavirus. Yet we are not alone in this, for God is present. That is what the incarnation and the cross are about. As we journey through our faith with its great mixture of joys, happiness, sorrow, pain, and uncertainty. As we daily take up our cross and walk in the footsteps of the carpenter from Nazareth, it is God who lovingly cares for all creation, in whom we are called to place our trust and our hope. And that all-embracing love, uniquely revealed in his Son, Jesus of Nazareth, his word of love made flesh, is the one we encounter in the Eucharist, and which we are called to share with the world in which we are set. Amen. So we affirm our faith in God who is love. My brothers and sisters, do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known to the world?
We believe and trust in him.
This is the faith of the Church.
This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
So, in union with Christ and in the power of the Spirit, let us pray to the Father. Lord Jesus, your light penetrates the secrets of our hearts. Be at the centre of your Church, that we may love you above everything else. We pray for your Church throughout the world, within the Anglican Communion, for the Church of Nigeria, within our own diocese, in our prayers for the Deanery of Battersea, for Christchurch and St. Stephen, Battersea, for Geoffrey Owen, the incumbent, on the eve of the Feast of St. Alban, we pray for all churches dedicated to St. Alban, and within our own deanery for St. Alban's chief, Father Nicholas, for all who work and worship there. Give us grace to walk in newness of life. Lord, in thy mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, your love exposes both deeds of darkness and light. Drive away the fear that oppresses and demeans. Give courage to those in authority to defend and uphold the good of all. Lord, in thy mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, you hold everyone precious in your sight. Look with compassion upon all who are marginalized and those who are rejected. We remember those who have been living rough on the streets of this and other towns and cities. Raise up all who suffer reproach and shame for your sake. Lord, in thy mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, you show great of your servants in their name. Lord, in thy mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, raised from the dead, you die no more. Hear us as we remember in faith and love those who have died. We remember those who have died in recent days. All those whose anniversary falls at about this time, including Arthur Charles Brown, Jonathan Clive Lincoln, Lillian Gouger, Tony Mason, Ray Graves, Lillian Emery, Roy Egan, Hubert Coxhead, and Bill Robinson. As you break the hold of death, so may we come to share your life in glory. Lord, in thy mercy,
hear our prayer.
So we come before you in a moment of quiet and make our own personal prayers. Rejoicing in the companionship and fellowship of Blessed Mary, St. Alban, and all the saints, we commend ourselves and the whole of creation to your unfailing love. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers
for the sake of your Son,
our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Amen. God is love, and those who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. My brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you, and with thy spirit. Wherever we find ourselves, we offer each other a socially distant sign of Christ's peace.
Thank you.
and supper with his friends. And taking bread, he praised it. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again he praised them, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this, as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him, we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross, bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation. We proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith.
Oh!
Let us pray. Loving Father, we thank you for feeding us at the supper of your Son. Sustain us with your Spirit, that we may serve you here on earth until our joy is complete in heaven, and we share in the eternal banquet with Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. The notices are very much as printed on the notice sheet, which is available both on Facebook group and on the website as well. Just click on the button or the link. One or two things just to indicate. We have had our first week of opening. It's gone well. We've had a reasonable number of folk coming through the doors and spending some time in quiet prayer and reflection. My thanks to those who have been here stewarding, ensuring that there is a welcome, and also, of course, keeping the place safe. If you are in one of those people that you might be able to help, perhaps just a couple of hours, do have a word with Marion Williams in the church office, because Marion's going to be redoing the rota for the next couple of weeks. Equally, if there is something you would like prayed for at Mass during the week, please do either ring me or drop me an email. If there's a particular day you want something prayed for, again, do let me know. I think that those are all the notices. A little later, there will be the bridge available online. For those who have signed up and who have the link, there will be Zoom coffee at 11:30. And then content will be live streamed from here this evening at 9 p.m. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Christ, who has nourished you with himself, the living bread and the true vine, make you one in praise and love, and raise you up at the last day. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you, and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.